Welcome to tonight's research topic. We have a very nice program on population health and proactive care for older people with three excellent keynote speakers, all with expertise related to this topic. We will start with Professor Jessica Kiefte, professor in population health, and she will give a presentation on population health for older people. Followed by Professor Jacobijn Guseklo. She's professor in primary care and will give a presentation on the effects of programs for community dwelling older people. And we will finish with associate professor Jenny van der Steen, and she will give a presentation about advanced care planning for people with cognitive impairment. I can imagine you have lots of questions during the presentations. I will ask you to put them in the chat and we will come back to it at the end of the presentations. For now, I would like to give the floor to Professor Jessica Kiefte.
Thank you, Rimke. So, population health management and proactive care for older adults, what is it really? And maybe it's also a bit new in terms of the medical field first, the population health field. Well, maybe, as some of you may know, we colleagues, we do not only work at Leiden, but we also work in The Hague. And we have there actually the LUMC campus in The Hague, which is a collaboration between the Leiden University Medical Center, the regional hospitals, the Leiden University Faculty of Social Sciences, and the primary care groups, as well as the regional health service. And interestingly, what we do there is that we focus in our education as well as our research on population health management. And it also closely touches on the general strategy of the LUMC, where population health is one of the outreach fields. And we work actually on research throughout the life course, so early childhood as well as older adults, and to work on prevention and lifestyle research. Also, we work closely with data scientists and work on mixed methodology. It's an interdisciplinary group. And as you also see here on the slide, when it comes to the LUMC strategy, value-based healthcare is also a very important topic that closely relates to population health management. And in the coming 15 minutes, I would like to give you a brief introduction on what population health management means and also how it relates to the population of older adults. Because with an increase in life expectancy, it's also obvious that also we have more older adults in the population. And many of these older adults already have a chronic illness. And by age, by increasing age, of course, also healthcare expenditure and also social care needs increase. Another thing is that we see that there's also health inequality, and it's also increasing. So what we see is that more multiple chronic illnesses are more common among socially disadvantaged groups. And this social disadvantage also make the problem of these illnesses worse. It exacerbates the problem for chronic illness. And this extreme interaction actually also relates to the concept of syndemics. And even a couple of months ago, the Lancet indicated also that probably the current COVID-19 crisis is also a syndemic that poses a huge problem on the healthcare systems. And altogether, also in terms of these syndemics, it's quite unrealistic to really stay in the way of organizing care when you link it to solely disease-based model. So for each disease, there is a separate care path. And especially if you think about older adults and you have multiple chronic illnesses, then it's unrealistic to really continue with care separately for each disease. So from that perspective, it's argued that a more population-based approach is needed. Still though, if you look then at the more population-based approach in older adults, then often you see a more medically oriented approach. So that would mean that you zoom out, you look at the total population of older adults, and you look at the different risk groups. And then if you look at it from a medical perspective, that would mean that you look at the group that is considered to be healthy, there's no disease at all, a group that is healthy but at risk for a certain disease. So that could mean if you have obesity or high blood pressure, and then you have a group that is trying to cope with the disease, and you have a very high risk group, or a group that has actually high healthcare expenditure with multiple chronic illnesses and also who needs constant medical care. But the question is also, if you look at where most older adults of the population are in which group, it's actually the middle two, is this the right way to look at health for an older population? So is this the right way to look at it? Because realistically, if you look at the older population, and the majority of older adults, they will have a health condition, or they will develop a chronic illness. But if you then look at more subjective terms of health or well-being, then it may be the case that these individuals have a better health than the medical model that I just showed you indicates. It becomes more and more clear, actually, also in healthy aging research, that healthy aging in itself is really a combination of both objective and subjective measures of health. So from that perspective, then we need to look at it in a different way, right? So also, if you look at the population, then we need a more integrative approach. And in the past few years, there have been actually a framework that is increasingly being used by public health specialists, policymakers, primary care physicians, and that is related to the positive health framework. As you see here actually on this slide, the positive health framework not only looks at the presence of a disease, actually mostly not, it's actually looking at also mental development, mental health, social participation, quality of life, even spiritual aspects, as well as daily functioning. And if you really embrace such a framework, that also means that organization of care is different. Because traditionally, mostly the goal of in most healthcare systems is actually to try to diminish illness. But if you look from a different perspective, and especially in older adults, then you may aim for optimal health from a broad view, such as the positive health framework. And then also this whole population health continuum is different. So when you then look at the population health level and you look at you try to apply population health management, you zoom out again to the population of older adults, but you not only look again at the different diseases that people have, but you also look at the psychological and social factors. And that is quite key, because if we have the population health management approach, we stratify on the basis of risks, but not only the medical risk, but also related to psychological and social factors. That also means that you assign different interventions. For example, if you have a person that does not have a disease yet, and you have, for example, the person is healthy and you want to maintain good health, then maybe certain e-health applications may work. But on the other hand, if you have a person that has no disease at all, and you combine it actually with concepts of psychological and social factors, for example, related to loneliness or social network, then you may intervene in a different way to maintain a healthy group. So then when it comes to population health management, you look at the population and you look at different levels of risks, both a medical and a social perspective, and organize care around these different risk groups. So that also means that you have a paradigm shift, because nowadays there's a more reactive way of healthcare organization. On the basis of a disease, and want to treat the disease. It's also volume-based, meaning that payment is on the basis of the actual healthcare service that is provided. Whereas if we look at the other extreme, or the more population health management approach, then it's a completely different story, because we first zoom out to the general population of all the adults, look at the different risk groups, and assign proactively integrative interventions for the different risk groups. And it's also very important that the healthcare is more value-based. And here also it touches on the principles of value-based healthcare. Because then you don't only evaluate the interventions on the basis of a disease or biomedical indicators, but you also look at the general patient experience or other aspects that are important. So you weigh the cost of the interventions against also what is important really to the patients and maybe even the caregiver. And with that idea, it's also the idea of the quadruple aim. So if you focus more on different values than only the money, then in the end, you also contribute to population health and reducing healthcare costs. So in order to apply population health management, we first need the data. But not only medical data, we also need to integrate that medical data with more psychological and social factors to really have a good picture of the population in the different risk groups. Then we can look at the different risk groups, what is needed in terms of interventions. And then we are better able to assign the right intervention. And a very nice example, actually, where also the interesting research fields come in, is actually, for example, on the population stratification methods. And especially in older adults, we have, a lot of research has been conducted, actually, in the past few years on different scores of frailty or frailty indices. And it can maybe an option to actually stratify the general population of older adults on the basis of their risk or frailty, or their frailty score. You could say, well, frailty is a general state of vulnerability to an adverse outcome. Actually, that can be a wide range of outcomes, as you also see here on this slide. But also when it comes to frailty, actually, it follows a bit the same transition as what I previously showed you from the population health model, the more medical model, and the more integrative population health model. Because there have been a couple of frailty scores. For example, the Freed frailty phenotype is a model that actually is based on a few questions where frailty is assessed on the basis of a few clinical characteristics such as low activity levels, weight loss, fatigue. And on the basis of that, you can actually calculate the degree of vulnerability. But it doesn't really include social factors yet. Especially if you then think further also about assigning the right intervention, then it's also important to include the social factors. Similarly, there have been also hospital-based frailty scores, which is mostly a measure of multimorbidity because it was based on the ICD-10 codes. Also there, you could argue from an integrative perspective that you probably need more other psychological factors and also social factors to be included. So later on, other frailty scores have been developed, and the deficit model and also the multidimensional model that actually combine both psychological and social factors and medical factors to assess the degree of vulnerability for older adults. So, for example, it included a degree of loneliness and the presence of a social network, but also the living situation in general. And I have to say that most of these frailty scores, they have been all validated, and they also have been useful in predicting adverse outcomes in various healthcare settings. So this is an example of the hospital frailty risk score, where you see actually that the hospital risk score was predictive for survival after chemotherapy. It was predictive for survival after neurosurgery. It was predictive for the time at critical care. Similarly, very recently, also in the Lancet Public Health publication was there about frailty, the frailty score in relation to survival from COVID-19, and similarly also the time to discharge. This shows actually that at least, well, with frailty scores and different frailty scores, it could be useful to predict adverse outcomes. That may be useful to use it for population stratification. But the real challenge is actually to assign the right intervention. So with population health management, we can actually develop a frailty score or a score system to develop actually a risk model. But at the same time, the next step is actually how do we really align the right integrative intervention to the right risk assessment. And especially also with frailty, we see actually that there's still some work that needs to be done there. So there have been a couple of interventions actually, for example, focusing on the reduction of medication, focusing on peer coach interventions, but also more detailed exercise intervention to reduce the concept of frailty. But also here, it is important that besides the integrative assessment of frailty, the right intervention needs to be developed too. So when we talk about the right intervention, and immediately also if you assume that also this integrative assessment is important, then automatically the interventions, there is also a more integrated assessment needed for the interventions. So not only looking at the medical aspects of the intervention and the medical effects of the interventions, but also the social effects. And it could also mean that you assign, for example, interventions outside the medical domain, more social interventions, depending on the risk stratification and what is needed in that particular group. So if we talk about population health management, then it involves more than just data. I mean, that is definitely a starting point to actually look at the population in the different risk groups. But the next step is actually the right alignment of interventions. So in terms of frailty and the older adults, it may be used for risk stratification, absolutely. But then the question immediately is, what is then the right treatment for the right frailty score? So early risk stratification actually go hand in hand with proactive care. And that is why also we need research on proactive care. And that is immediately also the reason that I think that's very important to actually invest in research that evaluate the different types of interventions and the integrative interventions in order to provide, to maintain health of older adults. Well said that, I'd like to actually give the floor to my colleague, that is Professor Jacobijn Gusseklo, that actually will talk about these proactive interventions for older persons. Thank you.
Thank you for the nice introduction, because I think we are working together in nicely in line. And I will take the following minutes to tell you something about proactive programs for community dwelling older persons that we already have proven and evidence on. And at the end, I think we come to a few lessons learned and future steps to what would we do next to have good proactive programs for older persons, that we can do really population health management in this population. I want to start with this small film, and it's going back to general practice, and I hope it's wonderful.
Mevrouw Loren, op de door. Ach, dokter. Oh jee, wat is er gebeurd als zij?
Ja. Sorry voor de Dutch.
De pijn, dokter. Ja. Ik ben bevallen.
Zo, gaan we eens even zitten.
En toen deed het een feestje pijn.
Dus aan de enkel.
Aan de enkel, ja. En toen heeft de buurvrouw me opgeraakt. En die heeft me toen naar huis gebracht. Maar het ging niet over. Nee. Gisteren deed het zo pijn, ik heb er maar een sok mee gedaan.
Zal ik dadelijk eens even naar gaan kijken. Maar ik wil graag even weten hoe het vallertje gevallen is.
Ja, dokter, ik ben gewoon gevallen. Ik ben gewoon ergens overheen gestruikeld.
Mm-hmm. Dus je kunt zich niet herinneren dat u onwel was geworden?
Ik weet het echt niet. Ik vind het stom, maar ik weet het echt niet.
U bent wel zelf weer opgestaan, hè?
Ik geloof het wel. Ja, ja, er was niemand in de buurt. Dan deed wel pijn.
Ik zal zo even naar de knie gaan kijken. Zijn er misschien nog andere dingen die ik moet weten, nu u weer eens hierop spelen?
Wat zegt u?
Zijn er nog andere dingen die u mij wilt vertellen?
Ja, ik slaap zo slecht. Ik kom niet in slaap en dan ben ik de hele dag zo moe. Moe, moe. Ik heb geen energie. En dan doet het ook nog overal pijn. Ik heb het gevoel dat al mijn spieren pijn doen. Ik heb echt spierpijn.
Mm-hmm.
En ik moet zo weinig in huis, maar ik heb het toch.
Ja, dus het gaat niet zo goed met u.
Het gaat eigenlijk niet zo goed. Ik heb plezier een beetje van.
Maar ik zag ook net, je bent niet op controle gekomen. Hè?
Moest dat dan?
Ja, u zal nog terugkomen bij onze praktijkondersteuning.
Oh, dat weet ik niks meer van. Ik dacht, gaat vanzelf. Krijg ik misschien wel een oproep of zo.
Ja, maar we hebben nu een kaartje meegegeven. U bent bij Vivian geweest. Kunt u zich dat nog herinneren, Vivian, in onze blonde praktijkondersteuning?
Nee, wanneer was dat? Wist ik niet.
6 maanden geleden.
Oh ja, slank weet ik echt niet meer. Nee. Weet ik echt niet meer. Sorry hoor, maar ik weet het niet meer.
Nee. Nou, we moeten dat misschien toch wel weer eens eventjes oppakken. Want ja, als ik zo hoor, gaat het helemaal niet goed met u.
Nee, het gaat niet goed.
Allerlei klachten.
Nee.
Gaan we dat eens in kaart brengen. Maar we beginnen even met de knie.
Ja,
nee, kom je even mee. Ja. Dan gaan we dan eens eventjes kijken wat daar aan de hand is.
Fijn, dokter. Ja, dank u wel. En dan kom ik van je.
What you see here is a doctor, a very experienced general practitioner, who illustrated his process when he was learning to start to do proactive care instead of reactive care. And what you see is that in his mind, at all signals, he says, oh, there's a risk of hearing impairment, there's a risk of falling, there is a risk of... So he is doing the proactive care and thinking forward in plus, instead of being reactive, he's doing that in his mind. And of course, you can think, what's the benefit to do that? You can say you don't have to be reactive, you have to be proactive, but why would you do that? Why would you look forward? And I want to show you some evidence what's happening when you are going to do some proactive care first at depressive symptoms in old age. I show you some data from the Leiden 85 plus study. For a lot of people, I think it's a well-known study, observational study, population-based, started in 1997, so it's very long ago, but I think some data are really good, useful, because we included persons 85 years old in that period, and we visited them at home yearly. And we had the mortality data, for example, for 15 years and the annual measurements every year till age 90. And then we measured all kinds of things, from grip strength to mental well-being to medical conditions to medication, grip strength, everything was in, and of course of cognitive function. And from this study, I have for you the depression data. Because we were interested at that time, so it's, I think, in 2002, 2003, in depression, because it's related to poor outcomes, we know, to poor functioning, to poor quality of life, to increased mortality, and there is treatment available, of course. And there were all kinds of reports that it was often not diagnosed or not recognized. So we had the question, what's the prevalence incidence in course depression in a general population of the oldest old? I think it's a kind of risk stratification. So we used the GDS 15, so that's 15 questions, yes or no, and we took the cutoff of 5 points or higher, and we called that depression. And what was coming out? When we visited those 599 participants, 15% had such a high GDS score. It's really high. And when we looked at those without depression, even 7%, almost 7%, got per year also the high scores. So the incidence was 6.8. And then we thought, okay, maybe it's fluxible. And after 1 year, it's just away. It's just removed. It's just solved. But only 14% of the cases were remitted at per year, and most the year after it came back again. And we really showed that depressive symptoms in this population predicts the functional decline, lower quality of life, and higher mortality. So we thought, so that's high, high incidence, highly persistent. It would be good to have more active case finding to give our treatments. And there was the discussion because there were psychiatrists in the team, and there were GPs in the team, of course, all kinds of specialists. And the psychiatrist said, why do they not get our treatment? We have to do something. Never know that it was so high. Okay, let's do a trial to give those patients treatments. Okay, we had some money and we started to promote a trial. And there was really the question, what's the effect of an intervention program if you screen on depressive symptoms and you give a nice, good, effective treatment to those persons found by screening? So we went to 67 general practitioners. We asked them to perform this study in their practice, and we screened all their 75 plus patients with those GDS 15. We randomized per practice. Half of the practices was doing just their normal care, and the other half of the practices, we offered their patients with a high GDS score, individual counseling at home, a coping of depression course, and if indicated, of course, a referral to the GP and a referral to the psychiatrist. So that sounds well developed, a good plan, no unrecognized depression anymore, good treatments, that's optimal. And that's what we found. Those patients that with the GDS score of 5 and higher were mildly, moderately depressed. We almost found no severe depressed older persons by our screening. And at 6 and 12 months, there was not at all any difference in depressive symptoms between the groups. And especially interesting was that in the intervention group, 83% accepted to start with the intervention, with the personal individual coaching, but only 19% accepted the next step of the intervention. So we thought, for all the persons who screened positive, this intervention had to be effective, but it was not effective. And what's the reason? And I think what I show you here, this is, I think, really the population health management. We screened, so we started on one side on depressive symptoms. We got and we gave them a very nice, efficient, effective therapy. And if we put it together, there was no improvement of depressive symptoms. So screening was okay, perfect. Therapy, perfect, but together it was not working. How does that come? Did the GPs not give good treatment? The psychiatrists were saying, of course, the primary care has to be trained. What did we do wrong? How is it going? So again, a very large interdisciplinary team discussion. And we thought, okay, let's go to those patients and ask what's happening with you. Then we had the episode study, and it was a qualitative study to explore the perceptions and the strategies and needs of older people with those high depressive symptoms. We wanted to develop new programs and we thought, okay, what do they need? So we went to 38 participants with all those high GDS scores, and we had interviews, both vital and non-vital older persons. You can also translate it to frail and non-frail persons. What were the results? All participants with the high GDS scores were working very hard with their cognitive, social and practical coping strategies to cope with their depressive symptoms. They felt that they could do that very good. It was okay, the score were high, but they were doing it sufficiently. And only a few, I think two of the 33, so it's really low but an important, they said, okay, we really need some professional support. So most of the older persons with depression symptoms screened by our very good screening program, they live their life, they have their own coping strategies, and they found that to be sufficient. But the GP in that case could be something, and that was the wise lesson of this episode study, is that the GP can support those self-management activities. So when somebody is coming with depressive complaints, then the GP can ask, how are you doing this? How are you dealing? How did you deal 2 years ago? So you can help as a GP to support those self-management, but the program did not work at the end. So, and then we thought, okay, this must be specific for depression because our method is okay. Depression is a very special disease and maybe apathy or things like that. Let's go to other examples. And then we look back and we had a similar experience in proactive care. And that was on hearing impairment. That was even 2-3 years before. And there was exactly the same. Because hearing impairment is highly prevalent, related to dependency and to poor quality of life. There is treatment available, especially the audiologists are very satisfied about their treatment. And there are still a lot of untreated older persons. So there again, what are the effects of a proactive screenings program for hearing impairments and that we offer then auditory rehabilitation? We did it nested in that Leiden 85 plus study. We did an audiometry at home and questionnaires, of course. And if the hearing loss was high enough, then there was auditory rehabilitation at home. Very fiery, nice, young doctor, everything at home, facilitated. The best program we could offer. And then, again, the results. 454 participants. Prevalence of hearing loss, severe hearing loss was very high, 81%. Wow, they are there. Screening is working. And then 2/3 did not use a hearing aid. So there could be our auditory rehabilitation program. But then 75% declined participation for the total study of the intervention. So they want to have the measurements, but not the intervention. And of those, 25% who participated, after 1 year, we went back and there were only a few satisfied older persons, and most of the participants could not find their hearing aids anymore. So they were somewhere in the house or somewhere else, but they did not use it. And again, there at that time, we did qualitative interviews, and there I think this is a very good sentence to summarize qualitative interviews. Those people said, a hearing aid is for me on this moment not yet necessary. So not for me, not on this moment, or not yet, or not necessary. And if you see this, I think if I'm going to screen in your audience, for example, do you need glasses? They say, no, the glasses are for me on this moment, not yet necessary. So this is, all the people are just looking like you in the audience. And here then the evidence, screening on hearing impairment, perfect auditory rehabilitation, no improvement of hearing, no improvement of functioning, quality of life, what's next to the improvement of hearing. So we did it second times, two times. What's happening? Two times negative. What's happening? Let's look at the LOTUS trial. The LOTUS trial, he was executed, was executed by Tom de Kraan. And there was about functional impairment. I summarized it only in this very small picture. At home, there's a lot of functional impairment, and occupational therapy is promoted as very good to repair your functional impairments, to improve it. So we thought, okay, we screen for functional impairment by questionnaires, just in the community, letting all the people, and then we send an occupational therapist at home, very good equipped to have those and to help those older persons. And what did we see? People liked to have the occupational therapist at home, but when the person was at home, the older people said, we don't have a problem. Where are you coming from? What are you doing? Because we don't have a problem. We don't have need for you. So at the end, there was no improvement of functioning. Again, the third trial, big LUMC trial, a lot of money, a lot of effort, but no effect. So what are we going to learn from this? And then I think the question is, all the patients do not have only one disorder. So the comments were, oh, you only zoom in on hearing impairment, you have to combine. And there we come to the frailty story, because Jessica already told something about that. We thought about, can we have proactive integrated care for those with complex health problems? And complex health problems is here a synonym or the same concept as frailty, everything together in something about the combination of problems in the same person. And why would you think about this, that it is important? Now we know that the organization of our medical care is very vertical, it's per disease, it is per discipline. And per disease or per discipline, you have a guideline and you have a nurse and you have financial resources and you have protocols. Oh, that's great. If you have only diabetes, it's good. But then all the persons do have multi-morbidity. Okay, but then we get four guidelines, four diseased nurses, four financial resources, four departments in the hospital, and there you get the problems. And therefore you have to go, or you could go, or you could hypothesize that integrated care is the horizontal bar, that it's better to have goal-oriented proactive care. Then you can zoom in on functioning, individualized goals, well-being, and that's much better for older persons than blood pressure, cholesterol, or other things that are per disease very important. So this concept was introduced to the general practice, and we had a proactive program on complex health problems in the in primary care. So our plan was to screen on complex health problems, to give them very well developed, integrated, goal-oriented care. And we wanted to see improvement of functioning at the end, because we know that functioning of older persons is very important. The name of the trial was the iScope trial, and it was paid by the Nationaal Programma Ouderenzorg. Again, a very big trial, 1.5 million euros, a very large group of nurses who were visiting all those persons. So we started the 59 practices. 12,000 people eligible for the screening. So we did the monitoring, the screening, we did baseline measurements, we did randomization per practice. We had the usual care, just normal doing, nothing doing extra compared to what's normally going. And in the intervention group, we did GP training. We gave them all the monitoring screening results We learn them to do integrated care, and we help them to make care plans and execute those care plans for older persons. And the care plans were about functioning and not about blood pressure and disease outcomes. And after 1 year, we compared those groups of 225 compared to the control group. What are complex health problems? Complex health problems are, the concept of that is that it is a combination of problems on multiple domains. So we have four domains: functional domain, the mental domain, the social domain, and the somatic domain. And we combine those scores. So you can have problems within one or zero domains. So then you are very vital, highest vitality. You can have problems in one domain, the social domain, when you are only lonely and you are very healthy at the other side. You have problems in the mental domain, or you can also have in three or four domains your problems. And I think this is also the combination, Jessica, that you told of, that you have to include also the mental and the social domain in things that are important for older persons and not only grip strength or weight loss. So then we get to the problem, the persons with complex health problems. So this, you only sent this 21 questionnaire to older people, big letters, they can fill it in on paper, very easy, yes or no, and you can see what the complex health problem state of the persons is. And for this trial, we said complex health problems is three or four of those domains with positive scores. First, the monitoring. So you see large numbers of people, you can do that. In primary care, you always have very large numbers of patients. And here you see that the median age is around 80, 81. And here you see the illustration of the complex problems in the population. So you see 25% functional problems, somatic problems 50%. There's also the medication in and going to the hospital. But even social problems in 1/3 of those who filled in their monitoring question. And when you sum up this, then you see it's more than 100%. And that means that people do have more domains together. And 0 or 1 is half of the 75 plus population. But 3 and 4, it's 26%. So 1/4 of all our participants were eligible for our intervention. That was the first surprising thing. Also, the GPs who are working with us together, they didn't recognize or they didn't know that there were so many positive domains scores in their patients. And then we go to the primary outcomes. Here you see in this table the primary outcomes of our daily functioning, quality of life, loneliness, depressive symptoms, cognitive function, all really relevant. And we saw a lot of variation over the groups over 1 year. We saw it. There was changing, there was decline. But we didn't find any improvement in the intervention group compared to the control group. So here you see the numbers, here you see the p-values. It's depending on what you want to read. It's an easy table. But after 5 or 6 years studying, the study team was really dissatisfied. Because we had the feeling that there was happening something. We had the stories about very nice plans and the people were improving, but we didn't find anything on those measures. And I think that's really to think of. Because you see, screening very good. You can find complex health problems persons with high risk and high complaints. So easy. Only 21 questions by post. We have very good integrated care, goal-oriented, but together we have no improvement of functioning. So that's hard evidence. And then you say, okay, but it's Leiden people. Leiden people are strange. That was, of course, the discussion. Or 1 year is too short, or the power is too low. And then it was so nice in the National Programma Ouderenzorg, there were 8 exactly the same trials with screening, giving integrated care, and functioning as an outcome. The one study did use the ISCO questionnaire, that was in Leiden. In Utrecht they had the UPRIM, so they had a very nice computer score. In Amsterdam they used another screening program. But the idea of screening and giving an intervention, having outcomes of functioning was the same. And if you pull them, all were negative. And the overall effect, if you would implement it in the Netherlands, it would not have any influence on the functioning of older people. The care was not more expensive. GPs were very satisfied. Patients were very satisfied. But at the end, if we want to improve the functioning, and there was room for improvement enough, but we did not find by this mechanism. So that's food for thought. What's happening there? And there, I think, and I hope that you can help us and that we can work together on what would be the next step. Because we have the feeling that having risk groups and giving interventions to improve a chosen outcome, that that's a good model to think about how to improve health in our population. But then the question is, what would be the risk groups? Are we going to screen? Are we going to select? Are we going to do case finding? And if we have a risk group, what kind of intervention? Do we have effective interventions for screened groups? I don't know. And then what could be the outcome? Is it quality of life? Is it health, positive health, or is it hearing impairment? I think this is the challenge where we have to go from forward to make population health management even more understandable and even more useful than it could already be. And I think our next steps has to be, do we have interventions in old people, those are screened, that improve functioning? I don't know. Yesterday evening I thought we have to go back to literature. Are there any interventions that are giving better functioning instead of just trying everything and giving no outcomes? Or are they not tested? Are they tested for people who come from the intensive care, but are they not tested for a screened group in primary care? I think that's the most challenging for our population and to think about the population health management. So I hope that I showed you some evidence that can give you thoughts about improving life for older people. It sounds so easy. Proactive could be good in the practice, of course, because you have your clinical feeling. You can have those programs. But as easy as we say that it's just population health management and we know everything together, no, I think that's not true. But I'm very curious to have your questions and remarks later on. I want now to give the floor to Jenny van der Steen, and she's going to tell you about advanced care planning. Jenny, this is for you.
Thank you. My presentation is about advanced care planning research. And as a researcher, my purpose is not to make you believe that advanced care planning works, but to show you the evidence and the complexities. My apologies for having to rely on my text, but I made a brand new presentation for 90%, and I hope you will enjoy. Advanced care planning involves considering or deciding about treatment and care proactively. Why not decide in the moment? That's a more efficient use of time. Indeed, advanced care planning for serious illness scenarios in healthy young adults is likely to be a waste of time. Population health management approach means that you target at-risk populations. Now, persons with cognitive impairment are at risk double for serious illness and certainly for not being able to fully participate in decision making. So what does planning in advance mean? Before acute decisions must be taken, before planning problems develop. With Alzheimer's disease, there are early memory problems, and that's not helpful in planning. Frontal lobe is affected in other forms of dementia, and planning is one of the executive functions of the frontal lobe. So just projecting a future is difficult, even with healthy brains. Let's look at the general population 60 plus. There are two major groups with cognitive problems. 6% mild cognitive impairments. And it's interesting that mild cognitive impairment seems to depend on education and not so much on ethnicity. And with dementia, it's about 5 to 8%. If we look at cognitive impairment through a population health management lens, then for about 12% of people, we are in fact rather late. Especially if we apply a palliative care lens. Regardless of risk of, for example, cardiovascular arrest, we can make the wrong decisions or take decisions too late, and we are at risk of decision regret or unfinished business. Let's have a look at what advanced care planning is. This is a definition published in the Lancet, widely cited, but there's also unjustified citations because there's a generalization problem here. It says it is for people with decisional capacity. You would look at serious illness scenarios, but what if you already have a diagnosis of dementia? Even so, why would you conduct ACP at all, rather than preventing unwise acute decisions? What positive do we want to achieve? Now, this review looked at underlying goals of advanced care planning itself. With advanced care planning, you can respect patients' autonomy, prepare for the end of life, perhaps reduce overtreatment, strengthen relationships, and improve the quality of care overall. But ultimately, we would want to improve quality of life. That's the ambition of palliative care and also of most dementia care models. Is it an overzealous goal? I'll get back to that later. Advanced care directive and advanced care planning is clear, simple, and wrong. Who is saying this? Sean Morrison. Is he some young doctor wanting us to go back to the paternalistic doctor knows best? No, in the first place, he's older than I am. I once met him and he said he's probably inherited his appearance from his mother, who did not seem to age. And he's an editor and he's also the director of the US National Palliative Care Research Center. And he decided that advanced care planning research in the US would no longer be funded. I respectfully disagree that advanced care planning is clear and simple. Perhaps advanced directives are, but not so the conversations about the future. It's pretty much a skilled undertaking. And about wrong, I feel it depends on the target population and situation. And indeed, the US has invested a lot already in advanced care planning and advanced care planning research. Now, I will go with you through these topics. Advanced care planning is popular in the media? It is. Popular in research? Yes. Is it too popular? Perhaps. We are overly pragmatic. There are products and tools all over the place. Is there enough evidence to conduct advanced care planning with confidence? No. And then dementia involves particular complexities. Now, advanced care planning is popular in the media, especially in COVID times. Forget about the D in advanced, because it's not meant for an elite activity for advanced clinicians only. Now, COVID-19 caused an upsurge of ACP, advanced care planning, in the media and also in the Netherlands. And professional organizations have developed guidelines for advanced care planning in COVID times. Yes, it's also popular in research. It was already before COVID-19 times. Do you know the number of projects our national funder, Zonnewey, claims to have funded? projects. It's a tip of the iceberg. It doesn't even include, for example, our work funded by the ERC. But the authors of the report used an extremely broad conceptualization of advanced care planning. It includes projects on identifying symptoms and the Liverpool care pathway for the dying, which should not start before the last 72 hours of life. So for advanced care planning, the funder refers to good practice examples, which in fact are hardly backed up by research. Let's have a look at the international literature. Advance directives was a popular item in the 1990s. And in PubMed, you can see an increase, even if we adjust for a trend in the PubMed database, that it almost doubles every decade. Dementia has represented about 10% throughout the years. In the Funded Sun and Wave projects, Dementia was 14%. And it actually fits nicely with the about 12% population, the people with cognitive impairment, so at high risk of developing dementia, and dementia. Sun and Wave, a few years ago, decided, like the US, they wanted to limit the advanced care planning research budget. So we, as researchers, have been submitting proactive care and palliative care proposals about communication, carefully avoiding the term advanced care planning. And perhaps it is too popular. Even at 16 April, nearly 3 pages with links were available to Dutch projects on advanced care planning in COVID times. And on the right is a snapshot of some products. We also published a review on palliative care and dementia and COVID, and advanced care planning was domain number one. So, are we proactive enough? Or does the evidence base suffice? We may have been working on a quick fix, people making and promoting their own products. The Sun and Wave palliative care program prioritizes implementation over the quality of research. And this is also evidence in that in our palliative care research journal, with the highest impact factor, receives a wealth of submissions from the Netherlands, but very few articles are being accepted. Let's look at the evidence Morrison puts forward. The review from Jimenez et al. Is an overview of 80 systematic reviews. And they conclude that there is low quality evidence that advanced care planning impacts, for example, the preferred place of death, co-concordant care, etc. But almost all research has been conducted in English-speaking countries, and indeed mostly the US. Now, the Mitchell trial was a pragmatic trial. Basically, they dropped an advanced care planning video in nursing homes and asked to choose from 3 levels of care. 22% of long-stay residents watched a few minutes of video about advanced care planning. And then the control, of course, was usual care in the US. And perhaps indeed the control condition did better than in some other countries. It was a pragmatic trial and the intervention just did not implement well. So do we have any Cochrane review? Because with a Cochrane review, we must adhere to the highest standards of reviewing evidence. There's one. 2020, heart failure. It includes 9 RCTs with brave outcomes, like concordant care, but also quality of life, depression, communication, and outcomes that really matter, even mortality, which seemed to increase. But the quality of the evidence for all outcomes was low to very low. And I know from non-pharmacological interventions that if blinding is not possible, you never get higher than moderate. So what's the problem? Why not even moderate evidence? Well, imprecision due to small sample sizes and attrition bias, so loss to follow-up. These are things we can fix. How about dementia? We have 2 reviews of reviews this year, and one is ours. As we wanted to register some time ago at Prospero, we found out that our colleagues from Flanders and the UK were just before us, and we decided to focus our review on dilemmas that physicians experience in doing ACP. And this was a very insightful endeavor. But we only have 3 RCTs. and the first one actually also in English-speaking countries. The first one was a pilot study in the hospital. And people just wanted to talk about the end of life, advanced care planning, but they did not want to document any choices. In the US, Mitchell used the same video tool in people with dementia, and there were more no-tube feeding orders, but not much else. In Northern Ireland, Kevin Brazil tested a nurse-led family conversation. Probably the most interesting trial. It decreased families' uncertainty in decision-making. That's something. The nurses were trained and the family was educated with the booklet. And we are now testing this intervention also in the Netherlands. What research we do not need? I went back to an editorial we wrote 5 years ago. At that time, we warned against a theoretical development and testing of advanced care planning interventions and against research not measuring and reporting unintended consequences, such as increased anxiety on the short term. Let's be fair on outcomes, considering such concerns can be a dilemma for physicians. We do not need research on how difficult advanced care planning is. There's enough reviews on facilitators and barriers, and we know there's often no time, little support from organizations, and people are hesitant to talk about sensitive issues. It's also not much interesting to read that advanced care planning interventions lead to more planning as the primary outcome. We still need trials, but adequately powered ones, and we should go back to what we should have done first. More explanatory trials to understand what we can expect if the situation was ideal. Now we go back to our definition. It just doesn't say what should happen in case of cognitive impairment or serious illness. Further, it is something that enables you, but what is it? Most definitions center around communication. It is a process of conversations about preferences for treatment and care. An advanced directive or a treatment order is not necessarily an outcome, although, of course, proper documentation is efficient. Enabling is very relevant. We need to know more about how to enable people with cognitive impairments to conduct advanced care planning. So what we did is we started another task force to develop clarity around advanced care planning in dementia. With the authors of the Lancet paper, we started with their definition and recommendations I showed you, and we come across fundamental issues which we discuss with an engaged international audience at online conferences, such as, is it still advanced care planning if we start without the patient? Their answer was yes. We favored a pragmatic choice to not introduce yet another term, because advanced care planning as a term is not very well understood. We feel that dementia is different. It's a special case. But some people with dementia actually disagree, and we certainly do not want to add to stigma with a special definition. So we need to navigate prudently and think through how to frame the differences. And recent developments do not include only medical issues may be helpful in this respect, and empowering patient and family as experts on what they find important in life. So what's different with dementia? Looking at how we revise the definition and the recommendations. Its capacity, and legally this is a dichotomous issue, but clinically it's a spectrum, a continuity. Its engagement. How do we engage persons with dementia? How do we involve them and communicate with them? And it's family. They need support in a new role as proxy decision maker. It all adds to the complexity of advanced care planning in dementia. Now, family beliefs, because family is so involved, are very important. How they understand the disease. So dementia is a disease you can die from, right? Our elderly care physicians believe so, 94%. But with family, after they've been talking to an elderly care physician, only 43% believes that dementia is a disease you can die from, and a quarter does not know. Same result in Australia. Just a minority of family caregivers believes that you can, that dementia is likely to limit life expectancy. Now, this is important because such belief is a basis for advanced care planning. It's how you look at the disease and also for comfort. Because in this study, we also looked at how comfortable nursing home residents with dementia were in the end when they died. And residents with the family caregiver felt that dementia is a disease you can die from, they died more comfortably. And we did mediation analysis. And in these cases, the physician said they were able to provide better end-of-life care. And the family said that their relationship with the resident was better. So it's very important what you believe and how you perceive the disease. So we can have goals of care discussions. Why should we have it? Why not have it all? We asked family again in this study. We can preserve life as long as possible, even if treatment causes pain or discomfort. Do you believe this is true for your loved one? Or would you keep it as long as comfortable as long as possible, even if it avoids life-prolonging interventions? We asked after nursing home admission to the family. And actually, 10% of people agreed to both. So why not have it all? Because these goals compete. Goals can compete in what we want to achieve, but also in when we want to achieve it. Is it on the short term or on the longer term? So we need to prioritize care goals. What kind of care goals? Well, with rehab, for example, it's easier to be smart and objective. For example, to look at functioning in a month or so. But with dementia, it's more often that it's a subjective goal. It's about maintenance of function rather than improvement. And it could be overarching goals rather than very disease-specific goals. But that adds to the complexity. And we can have more care goals at the same time. We, in a Delphi study, we created this model. And you can see that there can be more goals at one time, and goals can also shift over time. So with more severe dementia, you would find prolongation of life less important and maximization of comfort more important. And these two goals, maintenance of functioning and comfort, are most compatible with palliative care because they refer to quality of life. So what you need is continue the conversations because these, the prioritization of the goals depends and moves on with time, changes over time. Now, what kind of research do we need? If we look at care goals, well, we designed an intervention, actually two interventions, a three-arm trial, which has some explanatory traits. And one intervention is about setting treatment orders, and so a more medical approach. And the other one is about coping well with setting goals. And then we have important outcomes. One is observable well-being, so quality of life. And the other one is an evaluation of communication and decision-making. So uncertainty in decision-making, communication, satisfaction with the physician. And they're theory based because, for example, the first intervention uses shared decision-making models because it focuses on making advanced treatment decisions. And then we will look at moderation by readiness to engage in advanced care planning. There may be the subgroup who is ready to engage in advanced care planning, the intervention may be more effective. So we have powered for subgroup analysis if we get to the 279 patients we need. We will also look at acceptability of these interventions, of these two approaches and other interventions in six different countries, among acceptability among physicians, family, and persons with dementia. So far, the Dutch physicians, roughly half would prefer intervention 2, a quarter would prefer intervention 1, and a quarter has no preference. So pretty diverse. So far, I've been talking about research, and some of you may be disappointed. So what's in it for practice? So just a glimpse of some promising elements for practice. One is you should educate all, not just the physician. There's evidence that effects are more likely if you involve all parties. So also the patient and the family with brochures, for example, and training. You should involve the patient if possible. From observational research on triadic communication, they found that the family comes in as a companion and leaves as a caregiver, which means that the person with dementia is often ignored by the physician. We need to practice conversations. We will do so with actors, but we also offer follow-up e-learning with a patient and family avatar. We should avoid, suggest rationing of care. That's what we learned in COVID times. You can employ encouraging language, such as we can offer intensive, individualized comfort care. You need to use formats and forms because you need a system to make it work. So we should intervene also with the family and the patient. We can stimulate conversations by providing sample questions because patients often do not know what to ask their physician. As a minimum, you can always probe for readiness to engage in advanced care planning and plant a seed. You can get to come back to that later on. Then future research. We'd better start with doing high quality research now because the future promises some more complexities. If a dementia diagnosis is going to be earlier, even before symptoms develop, when do you start advanced care planning? Do you want to project a future with dementia that early? And then with Parkinson's disease, half of patients end up with dementia. It's an even more protected course of the disease, and we can learn from the complexities of advanced care planning in other diseases. In consensus work, together with Professor Bas Bloem, we found that advanced care planning should start before an extended palliative phase. And advanced care planning can include examining preferences for technology at the end of life. For example, camera monitoring of facial expressions for signs of pain. And then older populations are increasingly diverse. We analyzed qualitative studies from 8 countries on what's a good death with dementia. Actually, family involvement is rather universal, so that may decrease some differences with non-Western cultures. Advanced care planning, however, seems to serve mostly a white and highly educated population. We'd love to use the Campus The Hague infrastructure to conduct studies in more diverse samples. And we also need to monitor quality more consistently. I happen to have access to 8 data sets for me and my collaborators covering 14 years of use of the same instruments. And we found that families may increase on the report to have been involved in end-of-life decision-making. But that's good news. And measuring such outcomes finally should be part of a population health management approach. Thank you.
Thank you to all three speakers. Also from the audience, there are some compliments about the presentations. I saw there was a nice building up, also noticed by one of the participants that Jessica sort of raced to a climax, and everybody thought, oh, Jacobijn will give the answer about proactive care, but then we were a bit disappointed, and she raised more questions, and then it seems that Jenny gave some spot on the horizon and also next step for collaboration. But what I see, one of the questions from the audience, and it is for Jacobijn, it is about the non-results on the functioning outcome. The question is, does it has to do with the outcome assessment, so how it was measured, and maybe a goal attainment scale is more appropriate? And a question from me also, because we heard about the beliefs in the presentation of Jenny, where the target group, how much were they asked or involved in the interventions you presented to them? Was it mainly the professionals you discussed what would be a nice intervention, or were also the elderly people involved in it?
Okay, so 2 points then,
yes,
of the discussion.
Yeah.
The first one is about outcome measurements. I think that's a very important discussion, especially when we want to join the most important related outcomes for older persons. Have you come with an ADL questionnaire? Can you walk stairs and can you sit down? I think it's really important to develop more outcome measurements. But when you have a trial on hearing impairment and your outcome is hearing impairment, I think, yeah, you can have discussion whether it's an important outcome measurement, but I think that's really nearby each other. But in that big trial about the proactive care for complex problems, older person with complex problems, I think there it's really important to think about maybe goal. If you give goal-oriented care, then you have to have goal-oriented outcomes. So that's one of our tracks for the future for studies. And the other thing is, do you develop those interventions within yourself? So I think some interventions were really developed and already tested for efficacy and efficiency. And they were doing it very well in clinically patients or in GP patients, but I think not in screen patients. And on this moment, we are working together with an advisory board of older persons, and we check and we test and we discuss all interventions or solutions. So what could be help us further when you look at older persons to this kind of stuff, to this kind of dilemmas, future steps? And I think that's really valuable to work together with the group. And we hope to do that for a very long period further.
Yeah, because indeed I noticed sometimes they were not aware of the problem their physicians were seeing for them.
Yeah, but I think that's the case for screening.
Yeah.
Because you screen because you think your patient is not going to the doctor but themselves. So you are going to find them early before they go. And I think that's a bit of paternalistic maybe.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good for you to have your hearing aid. At the other hand, there are a lot of screening studies, screening programs in the Netherlands also, which are working. So I think it's in between paternalistic helping, recognizing earlier than maybe the patient is coming. And that's, I think, a very interesting topic to discuss further.
Yeah, because I understand, well, when we were discussing on forehand, you also mentioned is actually we only screen in the Netherlands if we have an effective treatment.
Yeah.
And here, yeah, we are still searching for it.
So, there's the law for bevolkingsonderzoek. I don't know how to say it in English, but there you can only screen in population programs if you have a solution for those who you find. And the question is, do you have solutions for those who have frailty and you screen for frailty? Mm-hmm. So, I think that's one of our next steps to think about.
I also see a question for Jenny, and it is, how do you actively involve family members when they conduct when conducting these studies without without burdening them, so without putting a burden on them, but actively involve them, and do you have to convince them with positive results?
So the question is about to engage them in developing the intervention?
In conducting these studies. So I think during the, that's actually, maybe if the person is still sitting over there.
For developing, we will use the same panel as Jacobijn is using, a panel that advises us for older people, and also the Alzheimer in the Netherlands panel. And for recruiting, that's a good question. So how much effort do you put in recruiting people? And with the trial I told you about, the three-arm trial, we say that it's not mandatory for them to engage in advanced care planning. And of course we say that the goal is to look at that, but it's not a requirement.
Okay. And then I see another question about proactive care for older people. So I think that is again for Jacobijn. Is there something to say about the role of spiritual care? The question.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting field to develop, because when we look to older persons and what's important, and we use the positive health concept, then it's only one of the six pillars is medical, and I think one of the other six is spiritual, and what's meaningful spiritual. And I think there are, I don't know whether there are trials, the screening maybe, and then give spiritual care. That would be a very nice try to do that and to get some money for that. But I did see some spiritual care interventions and maybe some effects. But if you have in the population, not within the care, but with screening, I think that would be interesting to see. But with the positive health as a concept that older persons like and doctors like and the policymakers like, then that would be a very nice intervention to test. So let's do that.
Yeah, there
together.
Are new, indeed, yeah. There is.
If you have the experience, come and we do it.
We are working on a nice instrument and also connected to positive health. I also have a question for Jessica. You mentioned the syndemics approach and that our current health system is not really, working according to that approach. Do you have some thoughts what is needed to shift our healthcare system a bit more, that we include the social and medical domain, and how to give population health?
Well, I think the most important thing here is that, and of course we still need studies to evaluate and the right intervention, but to really provide not only medical interventions, but integrate it with more a psychological or social approach. So this could mean, in the case of syndemics, especially how the multimobility interacts to a very extreme extent with all kinds of social factors, that sometimes for this group you need not only the medical intervention, but combine it with social interventions, and maybe even have intensive case management that also looks at financial problems and not only the medical stuff. So it is more about looking beyond the medical domain in terms of the interventions.
Okay, well, thank you. I see indeed from the audience, Jenny, that you answered the question correctly. So we interpreted correctly. So that is nice. Let me see, because I don't see. So I would also like to invite you sitting at home to put additional questions in the chat, which I can ask to the speakers. Let me see. Prioritize what I also had noted. Well, and maybe also you have questions for each other. I don't know if you have one, then hearing, or if you heard something, well, that was nice, and I see a connection for the next steps. I see Jenny. Yeah. That is
about positive health.
Yes.
I have some critique for persons with dementia regarding positive health, because the emphasis is on resilience, on dealing with your own business, and even if you have disease, as long as you can cope with it and make the best of it, then you have positive health. But then you set the bar much higher. So the most sick people are people who do not get there, and that's people with dementia. So how do you, have you thought about that?
That's very interesting.
It's
and
like
I see
1.5 meter.
Yeah, I see Jacob Wijn is going.
Yeah, so I think the positive health is an interesting concept between it gives health not only to the medical doctor, so there's only one pillar, but also the other topics are very important. And I'm struggling with how to use it in research, because there are 6 domains and it's impossible to measure. And on this moment we are doing a COVID questionnaire to all the persons, how the COVID restrictions are influencing their positive health domains, and it's really difficult to measure. And I think that's one of the work, but the idea that it's more than only pills or only complaints, but that there are other things where you can work on to increase health. And I don't feel it as a very like a ranking. It's more where can you give more attention to improve health instead of only medical. So I see it more as an instrument in clinician, or if for policymakers to think, okay, spiritual care is also important, instead of you have to reach everything, because you can have all the 6 pillars, you can have difficult ratings, gradings. So I feel the discussion on this concept, but more that it's very useful in practice, but not so useful yet in research. So, maybe we can have a nice discussion.
I think okay. Jessica can give already a tip of the iceberg. I don't know the expression in English, but
no, I think it's interesting that it's mentioned indeed, because the positive health framework is currently also used more as an instrument to speak about the different domains of health. But what we're trying to do actually is trying to develop a measurement, and it actually includes 3 concepts, and it is actually the more biomedical part, such as more objective measures, more something related to perceived health, and it also includes the various domains of positive health, and also the context that you live in, whether you're able to deal with it somehow. And I think the next step is indeed to see, are you then able also to capture differences after a particular intervention? And I think that will be the necessary next step in order to see whether we can really use this instrument also for actually evaluating the interventions that Jacob Wijn also mentioned. So it is a very interesting topic, but we're not there yet. So we're trying to actually develop a tool to measure, but we'll see how that goes.
And how does Jenny feel after hearing her 2 colleagues about the concept or the possibilities for people with dementia?
Yes, I like the idea of including more than medical domains, because that also for advanced care planning, it makes it easier for people to engage in advanced care planning, because that's what they are more an expert on the psychosocial domains. Yeah, perhaps I'm a bit concerned about stigma, because in dementia it can be very sensitive. And for example, the ERC requires to think ahead about how even results of research can add to stigma. So perhaps I'm very sensitive that, okay, the people with dementia, they may be the lowest on this positive health measure.
maybe we have to choose another name, because positive health is if you are low on your positive health, I think that's really
if you're low on your positive health, is what Jacobijn said, but perhaps we should invent another name.
Another name, well, I think that is very nice. Well, Jenny, actually another question for you I have, so you can come back. What I liked very much is that you included the beliefs of the treatment, and I was wondering, well, maybe that's also a bit related to what Jacobijn mentioned, that what I noticed, that the beliefs not always matched with the, well, the beliefs or the thoughts or the knowledge of the physicians. And I think that is very nice to start with the beliefs and what they think you need to prioritize. And maybe that also helps with, well, designing interventions. So, but the question is, did you mainly ask the beliefs of the people around, the people with dementia? Or do you also include the beliefs the persons have themselves? Is it early in the phase or the stage of the dementia?
Yes, well, so far my research has mostly been on nursing home residents, so with family, and then we ask the beliefs of family only. Mm-hmm. But in the new study, it's in general practice, we will include people with early dementia, and so we also ask them for their beliefs on the disease. And I look forward to see what the result will be. I think it's a very good idea to start with beliefs in advanced care planning. And then there has been research on shared decision making in dementia, and they found that you also have to agree on whether you should do advanced care planning, whether you should make a decision. So explain what's the importance of it. So that may be step one. Mm-hmm. And then step two could be to explore what they believe about the disease. Yes.
And I can imagine at least what triggered in your presentation and also from my personal experience, that indeed during the course of disease or during progression, that the beliefs or how people think about it change. And I can imagine that is quite difficult because, well, at the beginning you can ask about their own beliefs, but, well, during progression it might become a bit difficult. And then also, what if the beliefs of the, well, the caregivers, the care family around them is different from their own beliefs? So how to deal with it?
Yes, that could be difficult, and of course there are persons with dementia who are not much aware mm-hmm. of their disease, so that could be a tension between the family caregiver and the person with dementia. That makes it more difficult also for professionals to engage in these conversations, and perhaps they have to navigate prudently. So I think we need a lot of training of professionals on how to do that.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Does any of you, I see Jacobijn also would like to ask, and then I see we're almost at
so maybe to connect this split, because we are already interdisciplinary, but I think we have a lot of in the audience of clinicians working in this hospital. And I was thinking about advanced care planning for dementia. I think it's very important, early dementia in nursing homes, but also in a hospital, there must be a lot of things, maybe on acute moment, but also when you tell the diagnosis to patients about advanced care planning. And I do not know whether there are in hospitals also studies like you presented about starting in the hospital, starting advanced care planning, because now we can maybe make the connection from the primary care nursing home to the clinicians in the hospitals. So maybe, Jenny, do you want to answer?
Well, yes, so in London, in the UK, there has been a study, as there are still many studies on advanced care planning in hospitals, and also they start after a hospitalization, because that's kind of an acute unplanned hospitalization could be a good moment to start advanced care planning. Well, perhaps we should connect a bit more with geriatricians in our hospital,
That's a good plan.
Yeah. Jacobijn thinks that's an excellent, excellent plan. And by this, I also would like to thank the speakers and wrap up so we can close within time. Well, what I heard, there was a nice overview about population health management, risk stratification, but after this first step, and a very important step about the needs assessment and also finding after screening the treatment that is, well, that match also with the beliefs and with actually that you really end up also with improvement on the health domain. At least Jacobijn found satisfaction with healthcare professionals and patients, which is already very nice. But the next step is also, of course, you want to improve their health, or at least that they won't progress. So, and I heard a lot of thoughts about collaborating and next steps in research. So with that, I think we can end very positively this evening. And I also like to invite colleagues, if you think, well, I would also like to collaborate, or I have very good ideas, then I think, well, still the email of Jenny is visible on the screen. Otherwise, you can always email Jessica or Jacobijn. So, and thank you all for attending this nice topic research seminar.